hands right here. Come on.
Peace that came upon my heart and my life, and
I know I couldn't smoke no more cigarettes, so I bought a pack of cigarettes because they told me you can't smoke in this program. So I bought a pack of cigarettes and I smoked about 15 cigarettes in the span of 10 months because I had to go 10 blocks because I had to go to Times Square Church. I don't know if anybody's familiar with that. That was founded by David Wilkerson. Mm-hmm. That was on 47th Street. So I had to go over there. So I went there and they got me into this program called Teen Challenge. And this was beneath a crack spot in New York City. And I went there, I had a few dollars, I had all my money in my pocket, my $300, so they took that. And I went in there. Now, most programs, when you go in there, the staff is the one who treats you with hospitality and show you what you need and what you want to do. But this program was different. This was where the residents all came at me with Bibles, suits, clothes, shoes, and they prayed for me. They said, do you think that you can stop smoking? But we believe God. And you can tell that these brothers been through what I've been through, but they were clean, they changed. And I said, wow. I said, whatever they have, I want that. You know what I mean? So I stayed put. And every day we were reading, praying. There was no distractions. If you had a girlfriend, you had no more girlfriend. They cut that off. You ain't talking to no girl, you ain't doing none of that. You're going to focus in on this world. You're going to focus in on the pain that hurts you. And you're going to deal with this. You're going to overcome. And so you've seen examples, even the staff, of people who have overcome addiction. And one thing I've learned, that pain doesn't always look like addiction. Sometimes pain is dressed up with some quarter-man shoes and a Wall Street tie and a quiet haircut and a two-car garage. But that doesn't mean that they're not in pain. The picture just looks different. It's a different type picture. But we just have the obvious picture. We hurting. I'm hurting. But when I seen that, and I seen how it even just changing my life over and over, because I was thirsty, I was hungry. This is my only opportunity. Again, I had no job skills. I had nothing. All I knew was dope selling. That's all I knew. And I was 21 years old, 22. And I said, God, I don't know how I'm going to come through this, but I felt such a peace. But I went through the program. I went to the second phase of the program. I graduated. I went to Bible college for a year and a half. I didn't graduate then. I got married, but that's a whole nother story. But I will tell you this. Through my life, I intensified my testimony. You know, went fast with it, but I will tell you, it was always full of danger, but I had fun living in sin, I'm not gonna lie to you. You know, me running the streets and doing this and doing that, I was enjoying it, it was funny, I was embracing it, it was what I did. I was popular on the street, they knew who I was, so when I get the accolades, when I walk past, that was a good feeling for me. That was, you know, just doing something in my inside, so I was addicted to that. And don't tell me, I'm not perfect now. I still struggle. But again, when you were singing that song that he's perfect in all his ways and I have a good father, there's no question about that. Even when I don't want to be kept, I do things not to be kept, he's there. You know, because he knows the heart. You know, Jesus knows the heart, man. And all I know is this. For the young kids, for the older people in this audience that think that the streets are alluring and enticing, that's only for a hot minute. Because anything looks glamorous and good, but you just do me a favor and you look at people who lived in the streets 10 and 15 years and you look at their predicament, then you let me know how they're doing and what that does. When you look at the city mission is full with people, and the Salvation Army is full with people, and the women's home are full with people that's hurting, then you let me know. The mental health is hurting because of people that's hurting. Then you let me know what that does to you, for you. You know what I mean? It's okay to walk. It's hard when you're facing peer pressure to walk away from that. To say, you know, I don't want to deal with that because sometimes you don't have all the friends no more. And people disappear from your life and you're not embracing. That goes for adults too. We ain't no different. We stay on Facebook to get accolade like the pastor said. I don't believe none of y'all. Somebody stays on the Facebook for two hours. I just can't. You know, that's crazy. Because even at my job, that's all people do is hang out on Facebook all day. And they get paid. And then that's what they do. But there's nothing to that after a while. Sometimes, you know, putting all your business out there just to get attention and all that other stuff, man, that's not even worth it, man, at all. Stay focused, young people. Focus on what you need to do. Whether it's school, that ain't nothing corny about being good. Trust me and staying healthy. Ain't nothing cool. If you bored, go to the gym. Do something constructive. Go volunteer. Go do some hair. Go do some nails. You want to hustle? Go get a hustle. Go learn how to do nails. Put that on Facebook that you're doing $10 a shot. And help put that on Facebook. Learn how to hustle legally. You do your thing. Don't there's always ways. You know how to do hair, put that into practice. You know what I mean? You don't have to go the illegal route. It's good ways to hustle. But stay in school, stay focused. My testimony, I still struggle. I still got issues from here from getting high. When you 13 years old, you smoking angel dust, you sniffing heroin, and you smoking crack cocaine, that's very young. So for me to be coherent enough to stand up here and talk to you, for me, that's a lot. And sometimes I do have lapses. I do have lashes, but I know when people see me, they know it's him. You see, I have nothing to do with it. I'm just a willing participant in this show. I'm just willing. I'm a participant. So there's times there's lashes, but when I take two steps, because I'm walking with an emotional limp sometimes from all of that drug abuse and getting high. I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. I'm going to be real with y'all. And sometimes there's a struggle. You know, sometimes I sit home and I cry. I say, God, I can't retain. I can't do it. I can't. But you know what? Every job I had, I was always in leadership position, no matter where I was at, with all the struggles that I faced in my life. And I still have more work to do. And again, as I sat back there and I heard of them singing, I said, you know what, God? I looked at how I was living, and I just started reading Psalms 91, David. When he was talking about the sins of his life and how he did it, and God just forgives him, and he purges me and cleanses me and molds me. And when he does that, even though all my sin, my struggles, because I still struggle, you know, something that I got to pray about and be delivered from, there's things, but he never lets me go. And because of that, man, I don't know what to do. The type of love that Jesus gives, it's just a whole nother level that you can have. No man can give it, no woman can give it, but this is who we see. The crazy part about it is when we're hurting, we go anywhere else besides him. Anywhere else. Dope, drugs, alcohol, liquor, pastor, battery, whoever else. I do it too. You know, but God can hit call and the Holy Spirit, hey, Devin, give me one. No. I want an instantaneous what I want answer. So I'm not gonna wait for all that. I'm going to do what I want to do. So when I do all that, God is patient. He's patient. He said, you finished making your rounds? You want the real answer now? You know what I mean? And so it's like that. So it's always a learning curve, and it's a process of trust. You know what I mean? And trusting him and trusting him. And I still not arrived yet on that level of really trusting, but he has never failed me yet. Ever, never, never. I failed him millions, hundreds, thousands of times. He's never failed me yet, and he never will. And I just want to tell y'all that embrace one another daily. Don't never run away from people's pain because you don't know. You know what I mean? Sometimes, I'm going to be real with you, sometimes in the church I think we do less of loving people than we need to. We do a lot of less than that. We neglect, okay, you're all right, bye. God bless you. You don't know what a person's feeling inside. You have no idea. One time, Pastor was doing a class and Charles was downstairs, and I think Valerie was commenting, and he was talking about love and the power of love and how we need love. And there's no other way besides that. And this is what this whole church is about. It's just love, man. I'm hurting. I don't have to open my mouth and tell you that. Just look at me. I'm hurting, man. You know what I mean? And so you have to reach out, man. Stop playing with each other's friend. When you see people walking in sin and drowning in it and sinking in it, pull them to the side. Yo, let's go bowling or something. Let's do this. Let's get away from this. Talk to them. Pray with them. Pick the phone up. Because this is what we're supposed to do. We are not the world. You know what I mean? So every day I do that. When I'm hurting, I pick up the phone and say, yo, you all right? Let me pray for you, because it's something that strengthens me.
Amen.
You know what I mean? Because we know it. Some people are gifted on that level, but we know it. Don't neglect that, man. Because let the world see that we different. My sister's struggling in sin. I can't just let her do that. Yeah. Just walk away. Oh, that's okay. No, it ain't okay.
That's right.
You know what I mean? So my brother getting high again. He's slipping. He doing what he do. Let's be honest. But some people can't handle honest, but show them love. Hang out with them. You may can't tell them the truth right then and there, but use wisdom. Ask God to help you to deal with them, to show you what to do. When you see broken situations in people's lives, don't neglect that. That's real. Brother smiling in your face, but he hurting is all get out. Acknowledge that, man. You know what I mean? I don't know what, Pastor, but I'm going to tell you this, man. This city's hurting badly, man. And I see that, and I'm not just trying to be funny. I'm not just saying anything. The mental health issues, it's all generational. It goes down to families. I mean, I see it. I'm not even from here, and I see it. It's crazy.
Yeah.
And it's getting worse and worse and worse and worse. And be honest with you, behavioral health is becoming big business. They're getting paid off for that. God, the word of God, clinical is becoming before that. They're quick to hand you some pills and say, come back and see me. Come back a month from now. And I give you some more. I give you a bed. I give you a sandwich. But they're not fixing nothing, and they're helping you. So you're passing that on to your kids and thinking that's normal. But it's not normal. It's not normal. They say, well, you got PTSD too. Okay. So they're passing that on. That's not normal. I'm not from here, but I'm going to tell you, there's so many intellectually gifted people here. It's ridiculous. But on the same token, he's mostly deprived. They're not confident at all. Where I'm from, it's totally different. We don't have as much intellect and educated, but we're confident because you have to be, or you get swallowed up.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But the confidence, you need to drive people out of that mental health situation because it's serious, man.
Yeah.
You know, young kids and things of that nature, man. But the word of God represents this. Because I tried to get a guy into the teen challenge program the other day. And this was about 1:30 in the morning. So he talked to the guy who can apply him to get him in the program. And the guy said, he said, well, I was going to commit suicide. So the guy said, well, you need to go to dual diagnosis. And the guy said, well, I went to dual diagnosis. Didn't help. I need the program. Well, you need to go to, he was so dead set on that. But where's the power of God? You a Christian facility. God can't fight off suicidal tendencies and thoughts. I don't understand that. Why do you have to hand me some pills and tell me? I'm nothing wrong with that. I'm not trying to bash the mental health, but that's becoming the forefront.
Right.
And God is becoming minimal.
Yeah.
Because it's becoming bitch business. Because a lot of these people is like a revolving door. They're in it when they're 10 years old, they be 12, 15, then the kids be in it, and it's generational. Because God is not defeating that. He's nowhere in it. And to be honest with you, there's a lot of people in Erie that goes to church. This is a religious place. Relationships are totally different. Having a relationship with God is totally different.
Yeah.
And so this church right here, I've been going here for so long, not to give pastor accolades, but I am, because of the maturity. Yeah, maybe we don't have the OJ singing up here and all that. And all that beautiful 10 deep choir and all that, but that's okay. I'm not here to knock none of that. But at the same time, it's real. The word of God is coming across real. You're getting the truth. He's living his life. He's walking it, man. It's the character, man. Because that's what it's all about. You know, it's good to make me feel good and get hyped up and all that other stuff. But when I leave the church, I'm the same old street. Credible person. I talk the same. So what's the difference when I dress up and go to church and I hit the sidewalk and I'm cursing and hollering and moving like I ain't never been? Because they have no relationship. If they ask people who've been to church 20 years to quote two scriptures, they can't do it. Because it's not in them. Well, I've been going to this church and pastor this and that and the other, but it's no relationship. They don't believe in me. I'm gonna tell you this, man. You used to go on the street. I think somewhere down the line that needs to continue, that street ministry, the knocking on doors and things of that nature and getting serious, because the people are here hurting, man. We can make a difference with him. The difference, you need to go to where people are at, and no shame in the game. I'm still cool, it's all get out, but say, not a gangster no more, no self dope. Don't have 15 girls, but I'm still cool in my mind. That's as simple as that. You know what I mean? So, in even more cooler because I know the truth. How about that? I ain't smoking dope, ain't took drugs in probably 30 years, nothing. Not a drink, not nothing. Not knocking people who do what I don't. All of that being said, man, we just got to go out there because I think it'll enhance our walk with God as well. When we see the power of what God can really do. Because I know what he did in my life, and I just give him snippets when I work, and I know if there was any type of follow-up. And pray for me, because I've been talking to the pastor for this for many years, and I do want to open up a Christian drug and alcohol rehabilitation and say, you don't always have to be on drugs to be there. You just got to be hurting to know Christ. You can make $100,000 a year. If you don't know him, you need that space, then you need to get it. But again, a lot out here is compromising. Okay, in order for you to come in, in order for homeless people to come in, I have to allow them to smoke. No, you don't. You don't have to compromise nothing.
That's right.
Because I've been to programs that they don't do nothing. No, they don't smoke. No, you smoke and you're coming up out of there. They don't even let you go to the store, so you don't have to worry about getting no cigarettes. You know what I'm saying? So all of you cleanse from that. You know what I mean? God doesn't, there's no limitations. And forgive me, and I'm going to say this. Recovery, don't believe in that. I mean, it's a start, but it's about deliverance. God don't recover you from anything. And I see so much of that. You know, you gonna give me a medal because I don't get high no more. It's not normal to get high, so you don't have to keep giving me trophies and medals. You know, I just need to get on my grind. I need to get free from hurt, from dysfunctional homes. That pain that's really making me get high. That pain that's really making me be promiscuous. I don't have to get high, but I still got attention seeking behavior. I don't have to get high, but I still ought to do these things that people hurting do. Because I can talk to somebody to run away from my own pain, yet I'm hurting more than you. Because I'm still hurting because I'm not dealing with nothing. Some people have success to cover pain. Some people got all kind of degrees to cover pain because they still hurt. So they hide behind that.
Yes.
You ever seen a woman with a briefcase of, I don't need a man to know that, blah, 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 blah. But she's hurting. She's educated, but she's hurting. That I'm tired. I'm tired of looking at myself sometimes hurting. I'm tired of my own stuff shit hurting. I think, men, we need to come together more and be real. Pastor does it every Saturday. We need to come together and be real
with each other. That's right.
I mean, there's no other way because we know anyway, we are more alike than different. You know, we can be quiet and smile and all that other stuff, but deep down, we know.
That's right. You struggle
just like I do. We just hide it differently. Some people like Pastor Todd, I'm jealous of your walk, sir. I know you've been faithful and you stay strong and you boastful about it, which you should be, about the power of God in somebody's life. Because you live it, you walk that, and you want people to have it. You know, the pastor got the right man beside him. You know, we don't have to agree on everything, but I see that part, brother. And it's faithful and it's loyal and it's strong. And it's embedded with this. You can't have that much joy for that many years and it be not serious.
That's right.
You know what I mean? So people watch that. They see it. You know what I mean? We see a lot. We do a lot.
Yes.
I just, this we got work to do, y'all. We're not doing enough, man. We're not doing enough within here, in this word. We're not doing enough. And this starts with me. That's how I know. You know what I mean? It's not doing enough out there. You know what I mean? Because it's hurting bad, man. It's going crazy. And people like me that's been there, done that, yes, I can help, but you don't have to be there, done that.
Right.
No, you can have the love that you know the solution.
Come on now, man.
I don't have to get high with you to understand what that means to be hurt. I don't have to do none of that. You're strong enough to say, you know what? And the value that you have, yes, it's going to put pressure on us to live what's right. Because when you're knocking on doors, we're going to be held accountable now.
Okay.
Can't live like that no more. Can't do it no more. But when you fall, get up. Wash your face and get up. Don't stay there.
That's right.
It's okay to fall, but
get up.
Immediately. Wash your face, repent, and keep it moving, man.
Yes, right.
But long story short, this is a beautiful church. I'm glad that, you know, I came here after I came from First Family Worship since I came here, and I never left again. It's the maturity. And I don't think the pastor wants me to stay that long. It seems like he prepares you and then says, yo, go about your business and take care of business.
Amen.
And that's how it goes. You know what I mean? So With all of that being said, I just want to read you my favorite scripture that I had in the program when I left. As soon as I got in the program, is God blessed me with this scripture, and I never forgot it. It's 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, verse 26 through 31. And it says, "For you see your calling, brethren, that not many wise according to the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called. But God had chosen the foolish things of the world to put to shame the wise. And God had chosen the weak things of the world to put to shame the things of which are mighty. And the base things of the world and the things which are despised, God has chosen. And the things which are not to bring nothing to the things that are. That no flesh should glory in his presence." And when I read that, I didn't read the whole thing, it's 31, but when I read that, I thought about me. God cleaned me up, cleansed me, cleaned me up, and sent me right back in the same environment. Not because I'm jailhouse different, because I can go to jail and get big and lift some weights and pound and look beautiful when I come home, but this ain't changed. So I go back to the same corner I got arrested on, stay there for about 6 months. You see me in the same green and state boots and slim and smoked out and walking around. I think you see that all the time, constantly. They go right back to the same thing because nothing was learned. This wasn't learned. This didn't change. It's just this. This got bigger, but this is still the same. So the devil will love you to keep lifting weights and stay away from that word. Keep pounding that. Number one, we're taking care of your body. But when that becomes a number one priority, lifting weights didn't get you in jail.
That's right.
And I mean, so your priorities is different. So we know what the truth is, and the truth will set you free. Mm-hmm. So when we look at people, we know we speak with confidence, we live with confidence. And if we hurting, we're vulnerable. Let's be real with it. Yeah. You know what, sister, I'm hurting, I slipped and fall. I don't care about being honest. Because you know anyway. And if you don't know, you know now. But pray for me so I can stay focused. But then, this is a mature church right here, very mature church, grounded, focused. We just need people. And we need to hustle, we need to knock on doors, we need to get it because we need to know that what we have here, we need to create more here. We need to use it, yes. And so, whenever that, I don't know if it's too cold right now, but there's snow. But it needs to take place. But I just thank y'all for allowing me to spend some time with y'all. I love y'all from the heart. And pray for me as I pray for y'all. And pray for whoever does it, a Christian drug program for women and men.
Amen.
Because again, we don't want to compromise. We don't let them have, oh, we have to do this and we have to accept money from this and that. We don't have to accept nothing. We just pray. God is the provider. He provides provision. He can give me a job to provide, but he's the provider. If I lose the job, he's still going to provide. He showed me that time and time and time and time again. He can use a job to provide, but he's my provider. So when you have a program that's in his name, that you're walking in it, he is going to provide. We know big churches with money. Go there and tell them what you're about, what you're doing. Sell yourself the same as you were selling dope and all that. Just in a legalized, loving, and God-fearing way. It's no other way. But listen, God bless you all. Enjoy your day. Watch the football game. Love you. Love you.
When you clap your hands right here, come on. You reign above every name. Yeah. Sing my God reigns.
My God reigns.
Sing our God reigns, y'all.
Our God reigns.
Sing, Lord, you reign
above every name.
Come on, say with power and majesty.
Power and majesty. Dominion, authority. You reign.
Sing it again with power.
With power and majesty. Dominion.